Hello, everyone. I'm Kat Timpf, along with Pete Hegseth and Lisa Boothe, who's in for Ebony K. Williams. This is the Fox News Specialist. From the double down to the triple down, President Trump dishing out a new round of threats at North Korea. Earlier today, President Trump tweeted out saying that military solutions are, quote, locked and loaded to deal with the rogue state. A short time ago, he responded to questions about what he meant.
I think it's pretty obvious. We are looking at that very carefully. I hope that they are going to fully understand the gravity of what I said. And what I said is what I mean.
President Trump is also issuing a new direct warning to Kim Jong-un.
And this man will not get away with what he's doing, believe me. And if he utters one threat in the form of an overt threat, which, by the way, he has been uttering for years, and his family has been uttering for years, or if he does anything with respect to Guam or any place else that's an American territory or an American ally, he will truly regret it, and he will regret it fast. Okay? Thank you all very much.
And this hour, President Trump is holding a meeting with Secretary of State Rex Tillerson and U.N. Ambassador to the U.N., Nikki Haley. We're expecting some fresh remarks from him after it's all over, which we'll take to you when it happens. Crazy week, huh, Pete?
It sure is.
There's nothing going on. I'm so bored.
It seems the pattern is if it's 5 o'clock on Friday in the summer, then the news will be breaking.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which you get to deal with every day.
Yeah, and I love it. I love it. Lisa, what did you think about his tone today? I have no problem with obviously saying we're going to destroy North Korea if they come to us first.
Well, so I read something that I thought was really interesting in the Washington Post, of all places, but the titles are we on the brink of nuclear war? Probably not. And it's a quote from David King, who's the director of Korean studies at the Institute at University of Southern California. Try saying that 5 times fast. But basically what he's trying to say in his synopsis is that this time isn't any different than the past. And basically with the U.S. media, we keep missing the second part of North Korea's sentence. And the first part is if the United States attacks us first, then these things will happen. And what he's arguing is that the Trump administration is also saying the same thing, that if we are attacked, then we'll fight back. And right now, both sides are sort of practicing, you know, posturing deterrence and wanting the other side to believe that we will take decisive action if need be.
And the U.S. is also applying for the first time since the previous administration, the credible threat of military force. And without a credible threat, without your adversary believing you will act, you don't get any progress in diplomacy. If you really want peace, you better be prepared to conduct war. No one ever believed that Obama would do that with Iran, and therefore they move along and they're progressing toward a nuclear bomb, which is a preview, by the way. North Korea is a preview of what it will look like when Iran gets a bomb. It is perpetual blackmail not to draw a real line here. Otherwise, you want to talk about a couple of nukes that can reach our shore today, an intercontinental ballistic missile with a nuclear warhead? Try dozens or 100 pointed at the East Coast. You will live under that scrutiny in 2037 if we don't act in 2017. So this administration understands those stakes. They're talking tough because it's about time they do.
I would prefer to not be bombed. All right, well, it's time to meet today's specialists. She is a psychology expert, a television and radio host, and a member of the Donald J. Trump for President Media Advisory Board, and she specializes in the psychology of politics. Dr. Gina Loudon is here. And he is a New York Times bestselling author, a human rights activist, and a jazz recording artist, and he specializes in music and politics. Mark Steyn is here. All right, Mark, North Korea has been saying this kind of stuff over and over and over again all the time, but they know Trump doesn't have to say anything. They know that if they came after us, his regime's over, playtime's over, party's over.
I'm not sure they do know that, actually. It's interesting to me the way they threaten Guam. There was a story about 20 years ago when the North Korean thing started. It was in all the Canadian papers about how the North Koreans had plans to nuke Montreal because it would show that they were serious, but unlike nuking Cleveland, wouldn't prompt an American response. And I don't know that in the crazy way they think in Pyongyang, they're not thinking, well, if we threaten Guam, which is a U.S. territory, it will show that we're serious without provoking the same kind of threat response as if we nuke Los Angeles. We're dealing in a world where the most isolated regime on Earth is a nuclear power. And that should never have been allowed to happen. And so when you see things, as Lisa was saying, The Washington Post headline, are we on the brink of nuclear war with North Korea?
Great minds think alike, yeah. Mark. I knew I liked you.
Well, but you know, what a headline. Are we on the brink of nuclear war with North Korea? Probably not. It's always probably not until you wake up, switch on the TV, and there's the mushroom cloud. You know, that's not really good enough, probably not.
So what do we do then, Gina? What do you think, like what President Trump is doing now? Does he need to do more? Does he need to do less? What are your thoughts?
When you're dealing with a dictator, and we don't even know, to your point, Mark, we don't even know that his generals are honest with him, right? We don't know if a general comes to him and says, you will lose, right? Because the guy has a God complex. Let's not forget that.
Oh, yeah.
So if they come to him and say, you will lose, does he shoot them? Like, what happens to the person who talks truth to him? Because everybody knows a dictator surrounds himself with yes men. So therefore, you have somebody who really may not be aware that he would actually lose in a nuclear conflict. He might think there's a way he could win. That's a very scary part. So yes, I like the way that the president has stepped up and confronted the bully on the playground, Kat. That's what this really is. This is bully on the playground mentality, and the president is responding appropriately.
We know he feeds people to tigers. I mean, that's what he does.
But I think he knows he would. I think he does know he would lose. I think he definitely surrounds himself with yes men. But I think that one thing, I do think he knows that if he attacked us, it would be suicide.
But we're also gearing up to even more heightened tensions, right? Because in just a couple of weeks from now, we are gearing up to have military exercises with South Korea, and that aligns almost with the same timeline that North Korea is threatening Guam. So, you know, I think if we see this sort of rhetoric right now, if we think this is bad now, I mean, it's only going to heighten that much more so here in the coming weeks,
and it's
given
only
those two circumstances.
Very true, and it's only heightened over the last 20 years. Mark, you know, the last time there was a credible threat of action against North Korea militarily was 1994 right. under Bill Clinton. Since then, we've tried sanctions, resolutions, talks, yeah. diplomacy, all yeah. the international, the preferences of the international elite in the intelligence yes. and the Council on Foreign Relations crowd.
Right.
You're a student of history. Yeah. Has that ever worked, and can that work?
No, because broadly speaking, the Western world likes talking, and talking is the point. So they say, well, we need to get to a point where we're back in active talks with Iran. And for people like Iran and North Korea, the point of talking is to provide a cover for you to get on with your nuclear program, while at the same time sending your house-trained, bespoke diplomat to sit around the table with Europeans and North Americans, pretending to be. And you talk about history. That was the same way it was. I dislike Nazi comparisons, but when you look at the German diplomats in the early 1930s, they were respectable, civilized men, and they flew around all the chancelleries of the world, and people thought, well, these people seem like reasonable people, so why don't we just carry on talking and doing this and chit-chatting, and the world will come to rights. And it doesn't work like that.
Not really.
Well, here's my issue, though. If people say, okay, we have to do something, we have to go in there, we have to get all this stuff, most experts agree we couldn't find everything, and that would guarantee that they would retaliate. So I think that's where the idea comes from of let's not do that.
Well, it's a risk reward. I mean, there are some wars worth fighting to get to a just peace where you're not living under the specter of blackmail the entire time. So if you do play it forward 20 years, now might look like a pretty darn good time to do something about it. Just like 1994 mm-hmm. looks like a great time to have taken a preemptive measure in North Korea when they didn't have nuclear capabilities.
Well, our Constitution also doesn't allow for that, though, without consulting Congress.
Well, after 60 days, you have to go to Congress and get authorization, but the executive has the authority to take an action to protect the United States.
Well, and I think the difficulty we're facing right now is, one, there are no really good options here, because we know war on the Korean Peninsula could lead to catastrophic losses, as said and stated by the Secretary of Defense. And we don't really have a ton of leverage over North Korea as well. And so I think that's why we've seen, this increased rhetoric from President Trump, because I think he recognizes the fact that we don't have the economic tools like China does with, controlling 90% of the trade with North Korea. We don't have a lot of tools at our disposal. So I think President Trump, what he sees is that we have to convince North Korea that we are willing to act if you mess with us. And so I think that's what we're seeing with sort of this heightened, increased rhetoric from the president, also, quite frankly, the Secretary of Defense in these past couple of days as well.
That's true. And, Doctor, on the campaign trail, there was a lot of talk from this president about China and bad trade deals. And if we want to talk about leverage, China's the one that probably has the most. Is now the time to put the screws to them and say, it's put up or shut up? We know you don't share our interests, but we can find a convergence if we really push.
I think we have to be strong with China because, again, that part of the world really only understands strength. We've seen it over and over again. You know, if you don't come back as strong, you know, then they're just going to push back even harder because it is, again, back to that bully on the playground mentality. But here's the thing about China, and this is what makes it so complicated and tricky. We don't even really know when they're being completely honest with us, if they're being completely honest with us or not. So it's not like normally when we can use what is really an ally. This is not that. Sure. And even when they say something to us, we have absolutely no way to know if it's true. So this is really an international crisis like we've really never seen. We can make comparisons, but there really aren't any for so many reasons.
China actually wants problems for us there. They want us out of the region.
Yeah, but they don't, of course, want an all-out war. All right, well, Guam, of course, standing in the crosshairs of a potential North Korean missile attack, and the U.S. territory's governor appears to be backing President Trump's hardline rhetoric against the rogue state.
But I want to make sure that there's no misunderstanding. I feel more confident that if someone is to make a threat to my people, the people of Guam, that my president will say, if Guam is attacked, then hell and fear will fall on the attacker.
I wish our leaders wore stuff like that, first of all. I do. I think we'd all get along better.
If President Trump is watching, we have a request.
I think that we'd all get along better if everyone was wearing fun vacation shirts.
That was my Friday specialist request.
Yeah, absolutely.
I got denied by President.
But clothing choices aside, that's interesting, Mark, because a lot of people take the point of view of, hey, this threat only happened after the hyped up rhetoric, but he doesn't seem to see it that way.
No, he doesn't see it that way, and it's very real for them. They're dealing with basically 1950s duck and cover exercises now. They're being told, you know, don't look up if there's a big flash in the sky. That's only going to make things worse for you. And this is a very specific thing. This guy, who actually hasn't demonstrated he's capable of hitting a barn door, has said he's going to put 4 missiles north, south, east, west of the island, like some spectacular choreographed Disney aquacade thing, and we are supposed, and just to Pete's point about a credible military threat, the point isn't whether he acts on that. The point is we can't live in a world where people can get that specific about threats. The threat itself is a provocation,
yes,
whether or not he acts on it.
Very much so.
Yeah, that's interesting. Of course, again, the comment or the threat came after President Trump's comment, though.
So the threats came when they started.
They've been going on forever and ever, but the more specific one.
4th of July, I think that sends a pretty strong message.
Of course it does. I don't think anyone's disputing that.
And we've seen an increase in these provocations, just, you know, within recent times. So especially under Kim Jong-un. So I don't necessarily think there's a correlation with the rhetoric. I think we're going to see those increased provocations regardless, which is what we've been seeing. I think President Trump is just trying to make it exceptionally clear to North Korea, do not mess with the United States of America. I don't think he can get much clearer, but I think that is the point that the Trump administration is trying to ultimately make here.
Yeah, President Trump has great instincts. When he said fire and fury, and then the North Korea balked at it, he said maybe that wasn't tough enough, because they speak the language of toughness, and he's surrounded by advisors who are the definition of understanding what adversaries need to hear. I think this is far more, he's pushing toward brinksmanship, because only when you get to a point where someone believes you'll do something do you get a moment of diplomacy, or
absolutely,
a moment where you can walk them back. It requires a steel spine to do that. And how many steel spines are there in Washington, D.C.? Not a whole lot. Thankfully, there's one in the U.S.
Money made of Jell-O.
To President Trump's credit, Gina, China does seem to be taking this seriously, more seriously than they had been, at least.
Absolutely. We saw it with the U.N. vote. And I think the one thing that I found, just a little glimmer of hope today, was that there are so many retired military living in Guam, you know, and many of these people have no fear at all because they understand our military capability. And those who understand it best, who live in Guam, who've worked in military forever, if they're not afraid, then it tells me that we really are prepared in ways that the average American may not be so aware of.
Well, straight ahead, Susan Rice claiming the U.S. can, quote, tolerate nuclear weapons in North Korea. Because, yeah, you know, we should always trust that lady. All right.
Well, Susan Rice, in all of her wisdom, is sounding off about the North Korea nuclear crisis. The former Obama national security advisor publishing an op-ed in the New York Times, writing, "War is not necessary to achieve prevention," despite what some in the Trump administration seem to have concluded. "History shows that we can, if we must, tolerate nuclear weapons in North Korea, the same way we tolerated the far greater threat of thousands of Soviet nuclear weapons during the Cold War." Rice followed up on her comments during a CNN interview. Listen.
"We need to be very measured, very careful, very planned in our rhetoric. I hope that we will see more measure out of the administration and out of the president as he approaches this very real challenge."
So, Mark, I want to go to you first on this. What's your take on her comments?
Measured rhetoric for 24 years is what's got us to this point. It's because we've been listening to people like Susan Rice and the Susan Rices of this world have said, "Trust in us," for 24 years. And as a result, a one-man psycho state that has a GDP of $12 billion, which is approximately half of what Mark Zuckerberg has personally made this year so far, seriously, has become a nuclear power. And to Susan Rice, everything she says sounds measured and reasonable, but it is in fact idiotic. It is precisely the fact that the five great powers had nuclear weapons and did have huge arsenals that meant they had no pressure on them to use them. The smaller number of missiles you have, the more likelihood there is, because it's a simple use them or lose them situation. Mm-hmm. So there's more chance of Pakistan, for example, using its nuclear arsenal than there is of France. And the idea that North Korea having nuclear weapons is comparable to the Soviet Union having nuclear weapons is just completely absurd. Who's next? Yemen? Somalia? A couple of tribes on the northwest frontier province on the Afghan-Pakistan border?
No, Mark, I feel like you're so subtle sometimes. I just wonder. I'm joking. And Pete, I want to get you in here. Obviously, as a veteran and someone who served this country, I mean, can we live, to her point, can we live with a nuclear North Korea?
No, we can't. I mean, this statement brought to us by the same woman who brought us the Libya debacle, that brought us the Iran deal, which means we're going to live under the specter of that and the prospect of wiping Israel off the map. It's almost like they're telling us to live in this new normal, right, where America is not exceptional, where the world is level. It's the same thing they said domestically. Your jobs aren't coming back. 1% growth is the new normal. And President Trump rejects that. He says, if we are a hyperpower, then let's use it. Careful, measured, planned rhetoric has gotten us, as you said, Mark, nowhere. We should tolerate this. We shouldn't do anything to tolerate this. And that's, I think, the spirit of what President Trump represents.
And Kat, I know you don't like President Trump's rhetoric, but so North Korea has fired 18 missiles during 12 tests since February alone, launching their first ICBM on July 4th. So if you don't like the rhetoric, but what are we supposed to do then to counter that? Because we have had, as Mark has pointed out, we have had a policy of turning a blind eye to this and allowing this to happen. And obviously they're increasing in the technology. So you know, what are we supposed to do?
I first of all, it's not that I don't like any of the rhetoric. There's certain things I think you need to be very, very careful about when it comes to something like that. What are we supposed to do is kind of the question everyone's asking. There really aren't any good answers. This comment was really interesting to me, though, because what they've been saying all along, Obama administration and, of course, Bill Clinton, they won't. And now it's somehow shifted to, but if they did, it'd be all right. Mm-hmm. I want to know what happened in the middle there. Right. That's a really, right, really big difference. Like, don't worry, that'll never, ever happen. Well, like, it'd be chill if it did, don't worry. I feel like there should be something in the middle. I have a lot of questions about how you go from there. That's what I think, too, Pete. Perhaps they were never serious to begin with.
I agree with you. I'd like to know that as well. Dr. Dan, I want to get you in here. What's your take on both her op-ed and then her comments?
I have a two-word question for her. It's rather simple, so maybe she'll get it. Until when? When? At what point do we act? You have somebody who is a lifetime bureaucrat who has never negotiated the kinds of high-pressure deals with foreign people sometimes, by the way, that this particular president has negotiated. He is the perfect president at the perfect time for this exact scenario. He knows how to stand up to a bully, and he understands things that she will never understand about negotiation. How could she possibly, when she's never had the kinds of experience?
And Pete, real quick, when do we act? is a great question.
And you act when your national security interests are at risk, or the
security of your
people.
But you can't wait until you've been nuked.
Exactly. Yeah. But what we're dealing with is the ideology of the left, which has existed for 100 years. Woodrow Wilson told us we could win World War II and get peace without World War One, peace without victory.
Right.
The left believes that somehow you can talk your way to that. And I said it before, I'll say it again. Sometimes there's a peace to be found on the other side of conflict, and it is up to leaders to decide when that is at issue. And I think with Secretary Mattis and H.R. McMaster, we've got just the right crew to make that decision. No one wants war, but if we have to make the call to secure the American people, then we make the call.
All right, well, coming up, fellow Senate Republicans rallying around Mitch McConnell and the showdown with President Trump. Will it further endanger the president's agenda? Stay tuned.
Welcome back to the Fox News Specialist. President Trump's escalating feud with Mitch McConnell, sparking Republican colleagues, some of them, to rally around the Senate Majority Leader. Among others, Texas Senator John Cornyn is tweeting out his support, writing, quote, passing POTUS's legislative agenda requires a team effort. No one is more qualified than Mitch McConnell to lead the Senate in that effort. And moderate Senator Orrin Hatch tweets, Senator McConnell has been the best leader we've had in my time in the Senate, and he's been there a while, through very tough challenges. I support him fully. So is this pushback from Senate Republicans something President Trump should worry about? Lisa, I'm going to go to you first. They oftentimes say that amateurs talk strategy, pros talk talk logistics. You look at the Senate coming September. They've got 12 days until they've got to raise the debt limit, another same amount of time to get a spending deal to avert a shutdown. President Trump previously tweeted, maybe we need a shutdown, a good shutdown for our country in September. I'm not saying that'll happen. But what does this back and forth do to the prospects of the agenda President Trump truly wants? He tweets about every day, Obamacare repeal and replace, tax reform. Form and infrastructure.
Well, I do wonder what conversations are happening behind closed doors and if some of this is a little bit posturing. But it is problematic. Look, Republicans could get both health care and tax reform done on a party line basis through the reconciliation process, which is what, you know, they have alluded and said that they wanted to do. Clearly, they couldn't get it done on health care. And my biggest concern, if you look at something like tax reform, which I feel like would be the best thing for Republicans in terms of seeking reelection in both 2018, as well for the president seeking reelection in 2020. Particularly in what it could do in sort of boosting the economy, which is going to be a big driver for President Trump if it's doing well. But you already look at disagreements we've seen previously on like the border adjustment tax, for instance, and you have groups like Americans for Prosperity putting up a six-figure ad by Paul Ryan supporting it. Granted, I think that has now subsided, but we're going to see these same ideological differences that we saw in healthcare rear its head in the tax reform debate as well.
And Kat, what do grassroots conservatives think when they see Orrin Hatch saying, this is the best leader, Senate Majority Leader, we've ever had, and he couldn't get us to 50
votes? Think they're thinking, probably not.
I was going to say, probably Hatch's face does not look impressed.
But, it's just ridiculous. It's just blaming all over the place. And the bottom line is, I don't think they're going to be able to get anything done because the GOP, they don't know who they are anymore. This health care bill, what the best they could do was a liberal bill. It wasn't even a conservative bill. It was a bailout plan. And then there's a couple people that are still actually believing in free market solutions in the GOP. And then there's a couple people that are actually Democrats. They're essentially Democrats. I don't think that they're going to be able to come together on anything. I don't see it happening, no matter how much time they have. So they've instead resorted to just blaming each other, which is just a great use of my tax dollars. I'm so glad I'm paying these people. Hooray, hooray, hooray.
But Mark, to that point, what's been interesting is it's the moderates who've been mostly been unhelpful. Your Collins, your Murkowski's, you know, your McCain's,
right,
that have, you know, voting it down. Whereas your Cruz's, your Paul's, your Lee's, your Rubio's have come to play the Freedom Caucus in the House. Where does this blame lay, and can Mitch McConnell ever get it done?
Well, I don't think Mitch McConnell can get it done, just to get that out of the way quickly. But I do think there is a substantial chunk of people in the Senate and the House who actually have no reason to see Trump. They've concluded they have no interest in seeing Trump-style populism succeed. And I think a lot of the House and Senate leadership thought that what Trump wanted to do was get elected, and that once he'd been elected, they could turn him into a Jeb Bush or a John Kasich, and he'd just be a normal Republican president. And that's never going to work. They can stand or fall on how they implement, on whether or not they're able to implement the Trump agenda. But the idea that they can turn him into Jeb Bush with Kim Jong-un rhetoric is never going to work.
Well, and Dr. Would that...
That's
would that be beneficial? You know, in 2016, two senators kind of ran equivocal on President Trump. Former Senator Kelly Ayotte and former Senator Joe Heck. Is it going to help senators in 2018 to run from this president? Or wouldn't it be if they advance his agenda and it gets passed, it helps them too?
Yes, because the American people are going to hold them accountable because they've been here for longer. They've had 7 years to put things together. The president has had 200 days. So let's keep that in perspective while we're deciding where the blame lies. The swamp is not going to voluntarily drain itself. And so I think that when you put that overlay on anything we're looking at right now, any of these potential conflicts back and forth, the blame game and everything, the honest person in this becomes rather apparent. This president is trying to make changes that the American people asked for when they elected him, and anyone who's opposing him is trying to preclude what the American people asked for.
And what they said they could give the American people. They all ran on, vote for us, repeal and replace, and then they just said thanks, and now they're on vacation.
Right.
Yeah. Now, we just need another 8 years, and then we'll finally be on top of it.
We need 10 more Republican senators, and then we're good.
Yeah.
Our generational conservative moment?
I don't know. I mean, I've embarrassed myself pretty bad in my life at certain times. Never as badly as the GOP Congress has with this whole debacle.
We'll see.
I probably have.
I think we all have, for sure. All right, coming up, CNN surrenders to the PC police, firing its most prominent pro-Trump defender after he mockingly tweets out a Nazi phrase. Back in a moment.
Welcome back to the Fox News Specialist. Our specialists today are Dr. Gina Loudon and Mark Steyn. Let's continue the conversation. CNN acting as a hatchet man for the PC police. The network has fired Jeff Lord, its most visible pro-Trump analyst, after an online spat between Lord and the president of a far-left group, Media Matters. Lord was slamming Media Matters' effort to silence conservative commentators, comparing them to fascist behavior. Lord sent out a tweet mocking the Media Matters president, writing, quote, Sieg Heil, an infamous Nazi salute. Following an uproar from the left online, CNN canned him within hours. Lord, however, is defending his tweet, telling Entertainment Weekly, caving to bullies, caving to people who use fascist and Nazi-style tactics to remove people from air is unacceptable. I mocked this guy. Mocking Nazis is okay. That's a good thing, not a bad thing. Mark, what do you make of this?
Yeah, I put this in my Our Society is Becoming Too Stupid to Survive files, because this guy, Jeffrey Lord, was mocking an organization he regards as totalitarian. Media Matters tries to get people fired. They said something about me last night. They've said something about almost everyone. They have people who are paid to listen to you for the purposes of destroying your career. And so he says Sieg Heil to them as a way of mocking their Naziness. It doesn't mean he's secretly sitting in his basement dressed as an Obergruppenführer from 1943 playing Nazi. It's actually, he's right, it's a joke. It's the same thing as if Pete says to me, hey, Steyn, go and get me a cup of coffee, and I go, jawohl, mein Führer, and they decide to fire me over that. And actually, when we get to the point where you're being fired for stuff like this, then we are simply too stupid. We're saying there are bad words, mean words, you use them in a joke, you're dead, your career's over. CNN should be ashamed of themselves.
Well, and Kat, I want to get you in here, because I know you penned a column for the National Review over the Kathy Griffin incident. Mm-hmm. So what's your take on this?
Okay, well, a lot of people are saying that this is a First Amendment issue, which it isn't. The First Amendment protects you against government retaliation for your speech, not against CNN retaliation for your speech. CNN can do absolutely whatever it wants. Obviously, he was mocking. He wasn't actually saying, I love Hitler, I'm a Nazi. I don't think anybody actually thinks that. But if CNN wanted to fire them, they have every right to do so. Generally not a good idea, kids, if you're watching at home, don't tweet Nazi stuff, even if it's a joke. That's probably a good move for your career. But I think anybody with a brain knows this was a joke. Anybody.
I can't even pronounce it. So.
Yeah.
You're just covering up your Nazi-ness.
Your job is safe.
I've never said that before. So, Pete, Is this just more political correctness from the left, or does CNN have a point?
I think this is a double. I agree with Kat that generally stay away from Nazi references. It's just not helpful.
Just never worth it.
But the double standard is always glaring in that I'm from Minnesota. The Minnesota Star Tribune is as liberal as the New York Times and CNN is. One of their ed board members, Patricia Lopez, tweeted in April of this year, public speaking 101, no Hitler analysis ever, always ends in an apology. Well, 2 months later, 3 months later, she tweets this. This is a liberal ed board member. Is MAGA, Make America right. Great Again, the new Heil Hitler? Right. Been seeing right. more and more Trump sign off this way. Hope Kelly, meaning General Kelly, nips this in the bud. I called her out. She didn't apologize. She did delete the tweet, but she still works at the Star.
The answer to her question, by the way, is no. If you're watching, it's not. Yeah.
Of course. So to the left, though, you can get away with that reference because the implication is that, well, the right really is fascist.
Sometimes taking your own advice is very tough.
Yeah, she didn't take her own advice, and she's not fired. Yet in this instance, the double standard applies.
Well, Gina, I want to get you in here. What is your take on this?
I wish that the left were as obsessed with actually learning their history and where Nazism was rooted, which was in the left, not in the right. I wish they would learn that little fact and be obsessed with that instead of the political correctness. But doesn't this remind you of the guy that was fired from Google last week, or was it this week early, for the manifesto?
I know, it's like, you don't even remember these
days. Yeah, I know. If the news comes out, us drinking from a fire hose every day. But honestly, you wonder if he were a leftist who espoused their entire liberal mantra every single day, would he have been fired? And I would submit to the CNN audience out there, why aren't they jumping to his defense? And would they be jumping to his defense saying, oh, this was obviously tongue-in-cheek, right? If it had been somebody who agreed with their politics. I don't even understand the purpose of media anymore if we're not going to be more honest about these things.
Well, and to Gina's point, and also to Pete's point as well, Mark, if Jeffrey Lord was a liberal, do you right. think he would meet the same fate?
No, and in actual fact, I find that more offensive. As I think about it, my dear old mum grew up in Belgium under the German occupation, so she had no childhood because of the Nazis. And I think it's actually what's more offensive is the example Pete gave, where people are seriously arguing that Make America Great Again is the new Heil Hitler, America First is fascist. You have no ideas. You're the most pampered generation in history. You have no idea what it's like to lose your childhood, to have your cities bombed, to have them occupied, to have your family members. The idea that a guy on the other side that you don't happen to like is this German dictator from 1933 to 1945 is far more offensive than anything Jeffrey Lord said.
Well, and now Trump now CNN has no Trump analyst.
No.
Right. Well, shocker. Next up, it's Kat on the Street. Kat takes some time out of her busy schedule to hang out with the Mooch. Comedy gold right here, folks. Stay with us.
Angelina, the waitress at the pizzeria.
Anthony Scaramucci's last day as White House comms director was July 31st, but at Villa Italian Kitchen, the Mooch is still going strong. That's right. They've got their own Mooch. It's an Italian meal fit for a king or a cat. Like, that's me. Check it out. What inspired you to create the Mooch?
Well, with all the political unrest that's been happening over the last year, we thought it would be best to really have some fun, and what better way than to honor the Mooch with his own dish.
Seems like an unconventional choice, the Mooch.
Well, who's a bigger meatball than the Mooch, quite frankly?
I say that in jest, obviously.
Those meatballs are surrounded by imported Italian spaghetti with Caesar salad, and there's the Mooch.
So it's very saucy. Too saucy can get you in trouble, though. Do you think that it might be too saucy?
I think it'll go over big for tourists. They're gonna wanna eat it.
A little saucy.
Yeah, but that can be good.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a handsome dish for sure.
Definitely.
But I'm worried it won't have enough substance.
Oh, the meatballs itself will give you the substance. It's no bigger meatball.
How do you know that the Mooch is qualified for lunch?
First off, it's front-stabbingly delicious.
Oh.
So
you've got to get together and, you know, mix it up a little bit.
Would you bring it home to Mama?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely?
Absolutely.
Do you think that the Mooch is a good representative for America?
Yeah, it's very rich.
Very rich.
Yeah.
A lot of rich moments, that's for sure.
If she supplies hair and makeup, I will consider it.
Well, it ends on the 13th of Sunday. It's only for 11 days. Get it, Kat? 11 days.
I get it. It seems almost like it'll be over before it started.
I'd like to see it here a little bit longer. Mooch should be here a lot longer than 11 days.
I have the stomach and the backbone, no problem.
I'll give the Mooch a whirl. Now, do you need Parmesan, or is the Mooch cheesy enough on its own?
The Mooch is cheesy enough on its own. There's Parmesan on the Caesar salad.
This is tremendous. I love this. This is the best spaghetti and meatballs ever. I can tell it was made by good people, very good people.
I like the team. Let me rephrase that. I love the team.
No one's ever going to forget something this saucy. Very, very handsome. Look at this handsome, handsome saucy dish.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Anybody want to? Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
The Mooch.
I didn't eat lunch. I didn't eat lunch or dinner.
I've already eaten spaghetti on TV once today. So, really? I guess technically.
Just to the Mooch.
Okay.
Pretty good.
And are these actual meatballs or body parts of Mooch's enemies?
Yeah, you don't really know.
I hope not.
Because this looks like a little bit of Steve Bannon and Sean Spicer.
You're wrong. I believe it's Reince Priebus.
Oh, right.
That's true.
Great. That's great. I'll have the full Reince.
I just want to know why I'm always the one that shows up in the light-colored outfit when there's food that's this delicious.
Yeah, that's scary.
And gooey and ooey. Yeah.
We won't judge you if you spill on yourself.
It could happen.
Basically, it happens to me every day.
Is this really an 11-day promotion?
Yeah, it's the last day to get it is Sunday.
It's a brilliant marketing.
Yeah, so only 11 days.
We've had it, so we can check it off.
Just like the Mooch.
It's the bucket list.
All right. Well, the legend of Anthony Scaramucci is a gift that just keeps on giving. Saturday Night Live alum Bill Hader delivered his best impersonation of the former White House comms director during a summer edition of the show's Weekend Update last night.
Everybody loves the Mooch. You know how you miss me. I'm like human cocaine. You got a little bump of me. I made you feel excited, but I was out of your system too quick. And now that I'm gone, you're all depressed and edgy, and you're trying to figure out how to score some more Scaramooch.
I gotta say, I don't entirely disagree with the premise of that sketch.
I don't know. I think that's a little, and I say this as a foreigner, but I thought he went a little too, yo, Vinny, in that. I think actually the Mooch is slightly smoother.
Sophisticated.
Also, sophisticated.
The Mooch is going down as a legend.
Yeah. This guy, totally never forgotten.
He sold Skybridge Capital for $12 billion. He's footloose and fancy free. He's going on Stephen Colbert on Monday night for an exclusive interview. I think the first interview that he's given since he's left the White House. I mean, this guy he's probably going to be on Dancing with the Stars.
The book will
be
a bestseller.
On Ellen.
And he has a meatball.
He's got a meatball name. I don't have anything named after me.
If it's a business, I would like
a meatball named anything.
If he goes on Dancing with the Stars, though, he should do the Mooch because it sounds like it's a dance craze where you make smooth moves and then whisper obscenity. In your partner's
You're a jazz guy. Like, I'm a jazz guy.
Maybe with a meatball in each hand, and he can name one Lisa.
There we go.
Because she wants a meatball named after, and since there are two.
I'm going to embarrass Pete, because during the break, he was singing, You've Got the Mooch.
Baby.
It's very catchy.
He's a business guy. Think about it. Those 11 days have maybe the best return on investment you've ever seen. Instant national celebrity and a chief of staff fired, and your Saturday Night Live skit.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right? I mean, come on.
Win. A lot of winning.
We've got to say goodbye to our specialists, Gina Loudon and Mark Steyn. Thank you both for joining us. Up next, it's Wait What? Plus, fresh remarks from President Trump on North Korea may be coming momentarily. So don't go away.
Welcome back to The Specialist. In moments, we'll be hearing from President Trump. He's still in Bedminster. He's following a meeting with Secretary of State Rex Tillerson and UN Ambassador Nikki Haley. And as soon as we have that, we will bring that to you. But now, it's time for our last segment today. It is time for...
What?
And I will kick things off. I found an article in Campus Reform today. The new school here in New York City has published an extensive guide on microaggressions. I think we have a screen on that. We've heard a lot about this, but this goes even further. To warn students that such behavior is damaging, obviously. It's monuments, artworks, any caricatures that are predominantly white for cisgendered men and women. For instance, could be deemed an environmental microaggression. Finally, professors who fail to ask students for their preferred pronouns or who assign too many readings by white cisgender men are likewise considered guilty of microaggressions students. I'm reminded of one thing in our higher education, a quote by Abraham Lincoln, the philosophy of the schoolroom in one generation becomes the philosophy of government in the next. I wonder why people vote for Bernie Sanders, because they're taught socialism and cisgenderness.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, we actually have the president coming out right now, likely to make some remarks following his meeting with the Secretary of State.
Thank you, everybody. We had a very good meeting. We talked about North Korea, as you can imagine. We're very much in agreement. I think we're very unified, and we have been right from the beginning.